We continue in prayer. Father, we thank you this morning. We bless your name. Thank you for what you have promised to do. And thank you, Lord, for the theme of this retreat. Readiness for Christ's return, for Christ's coming. Lord, we pray in every way possible. All the blessings we need to get us ready, you get us prepared in Jesus' name. Amen. We pray that none of us will miss your blessing. We pray, Lord, what you want to do in our lives, according to your promises and according to your faithfulness, you perform and do in every life in Jesus' name. Amen. We pray that our hearts will center on you. We'll seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And in all the other things, you will pleasantly add to every life in Jesus' name. Help us, Lord, to be faithful to your word, faithful to your calling upon our lives, and faithful to what Calvary has provided for every life. We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. We're coming this morning to the word of God, Hebrews chapter 10. And I'm reading from verse 19. Hebrews chapter 10, reading from verse 19. Having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter into the holiest by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way, which he has consecrated for us through the veil, that is to say, his flesh, and having an high priest over the house of God. Let us draw near with a true heart, in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience, and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering, for he is faithful that promised. As we come to the faith clinic this morning, I want to talk about the blood of Jesus. The blood is shed for you, the blood is shed for me, and the blood is shed for the whole of humanity. We're looking at the benefits of his blood, the benefits of the blood of Jesus Christ, effectively the benefits of his death, the benefits of his sacrifice, the benefits of his provision coming from Calvary. Here he tells us, we now have boldness to enter into the holiest by the blood of Jesus. Look at that in verse 19 again. He's talking to the brethren. He's talking to the people that know the value, the efficacy of the blood of Jesus Christ. And he says, we have boldness. What gives us the boldness? Now we can come into the very presence of God, and we can come to the holiest place of the Lord. He's telling us we can come not just to the outer court of the sanctuary, not just to the premises of the sanctuary. We can come into the holy place itself. We can come into the holy of holies. We can come to the holiest. We can get saved. We can get sanctified. We can be made holy. We can be made godly and righteous. And we can have the power of God in our lives. Our boldness to claim the promises of the Lord. Having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter. And there is no uncertainty. There is no doubt. There is no unbelief. And there is no suggestion as if, what if it does not happen? What if we try to enter and we're driven back? It says we have the assurance to enter. We have the boldness to enter. And we have the promises of the Lord. We can easily come unto him. Boldness to enter into the holiest. How do we do that? By the blood. The blood that saves. The blood that cleanses. The blood that transforms our lives. And the blood that provides all the benefits of redemption. Boldness to enter, so that we can have that blood paving the way for us. Then it goes on in verse 20. It says, it's by a new and living way, which he has consecrated, set apart for you and for me, for us. And it says, it's through the veil, that is to say, his flesh. That body was broken for you. The body was pierced for you. And the blood gushed out just for you. Then he goes on to say, we now have him as our high priest. He stands between us and God. He represents God to us. And he represents us to God. He says, because of what he has done already, let us draw near with a true heart. We go back to Calvary. If there is any sin in our lives, we confess and we forsake. We get rid of them. And now we can come with a true heart, a clean heart, a pure heart, an honest heart, in full assurance of faith. That means there's no iota of doubt in us because we have that full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled, washed, cleansed as with pure water. And then from evil conscience, we now have that boldness that not guilt nor condemnation can hinder. Let us hold fast there the profession, declaration of our faith without wavering, because he is faithful that promised. As we come to chapter 9, Hebrews chapter 9, reading from verse 11. Hebrews chapter 9, verse 11. It says, but Christ, being come and high priest of good things to come. Good things to come, in the sense that the blessings we receive in the new covenant, they're greater than the blessings they received in the old covenant. They had a lot. They received a lot. And they benefited a lot from the sacrifices they made, because God commanded them to make those sacrifices. And he gave them the promise that if this was done, he was going to also do that in their lives. And it says now that we in the new covenant, we have something greater, something higher, something more beautiful, something more wonderful. It says we have greater benefits. And those are the benefits we're looking at today. It says it's by greater and a more perfect tabernacle not made with hands. That is to say, not of this building. Verse 12, neither by the blood of goats and calves, but by his own blood, he entered in once into the holy place, having obtained eternal redemption for us. He has obtained redemption for us. And he has obtained that redemption by that one sacrifice for generations after Calvary, for generations after he died on the cross of Calvary, until this day, in fact, until we enter into eternity. For if the blood of bulls and of goats and the ashes of an heifer sprinkling the unclean sanctifies to the purifying of the flesh. Again, it's returning to the old covenant. And that if the blood of animals did the cleansing and did the conversion and did the purification at that time, how much more? In verse 14, how much more? It makes you to expect more from the blood of Jesus Christ. Makes you to expect more from the sacrifice of Jesus Christ than you could ever get under the old covenant. How much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal spirit offered himself without spot to God, purge your conscience, purge your heart, purge your inner man, purge your spirit, purge your soul. How much more will the blood of Jesus Christ purge you and purge you internally to the point you're clean without any blemish at all, from dead works to serve the living God? It tells us in verse 22, chapter 9, verse 22, and almost all things are by the law purged with blood, and without shedding of blood is no remission. It's talking about the shedding of the blood of Jesus Christ. Without the shedding of the blood of Jesus Christ is no removal of sin, it's no remission, no forgiveness, it's no redemption, it's no salvation. Only through that blood can we have salvation today. We're looking at 3 points under this topic. benefits through his blood. Number one, peace and pardon through his blood. Peace and pardon through his blood. The sinner is guilty. The sinner is condemned. There is no peace, says the Lord, to the wicked. How can you have peace then? How can you come into the peace of the Lord, into the peace of God, the peace that passes understanding, through the blood that is shed for you on the cross of Calvary? And pardon, he forgives, because except those sins are forgiven, the little ones and the big ones, the public ones and the private ones, the known ones and the secret ones, except they're pardoned, you will not be able to get to the kingdom of God. And so to have the salvation of the Lord, and to be so clear, so clean, and to be so prepared, you're able to enter, you need the pardon of the Lord, and that comes through the blood of Jesus. Peace and pardon through his blood. Number two, purity and power through his blood. Purity and power through his blood. He removes that Adamic nature. He removes that tendency to want to sin. He removes the liking to sin, the desire to sin, and purifies us so that we're not just holy and righteous externally, outwardly, but inwardly, we're holy. Inwardly, we're pure. Because he removes that sin within us that is very root of sin, the root of bitterness, and the root of evil. Purity and power through his blood. And then number three, we have protection and provision through his blood. All we need for this life, all we need for godliness, all we need to make us victorious in every way, he has given us through the blood of the Lamb. Protection and provision through his blood. We come to number one, peace and pardon through his blood. Peace and pardon through his blood. You understand how important peace is. Without peace, what can you do in life? If you have a confused mind, an agitated mind, a condemned mind, a guilty soul, a guilty heart, how far can you go? If you are followed by the shadow of your sin, you cannot have peace. But when you come to the Lord Jesus Christ, turn away from that sin, repent of that sin, and then you apply to the efficacy and to the sufficiency of the blood of Jesus Christ, pardon comes and peace comes. In Romans chapter 3, Romans chapter 3, reading from verse 23, it says, for all have sinned. All have sinned. You have not all committed all the sins of the other people, but you have committed your own sins. Not everybody sins the same way. Different people commit different sins. And it says, all have sinned. The small, the great, the lowly, the high, the educated, the uneducated, all have sinned. And so everybody has become guilty. Sin brings guilt. Sin brings condemnation. Sin brings judgment. And sin attracts heaven's punishment. All have sinned, and so all are liable to the guilt, the condemnation, the punishment, and the judgment because of sin. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God has set forth to be a propitiation, that means an atonement, an acceptable sacrifice, through faith in his blood. See that? Through faith in his blood. You understand? He died for you. He took your place. And because he died for you and he took your place, that's why you can have that peace. That's why you can have the pardon. It's through the atonement he made. It's through the sacrifice he made. You've come to the Lord. You're telling the Lord, I merit death. The soul that sinneth, it shall die. But I thank you, Lord, because you love me so much. and you send Jesus Christ to take my place. Jesus Christ to be my substitute. He bore my sorrows. He bore my sin. He bore my punishment. He bore my evil. He bore the consequence of everything I have done. And because of that sacrifice, because of that substitution, and because of sin-bearing activity that happened on the cross, I can now come and I can take his place as he has taken my place. Look at it again from verse 24. Being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God set forth. It's God himself that appointed him, that set him forth, that ordained him, and that approved him to be the propitiation, the sacrifice, the atonement, the redeemer through faith in his blood. As you have faith in his blood now, the benefit of Calvary comes to you, and the benefit of that forgiveness comes to you. The benefit of that redemption becomes yours. It says to declare his righteousness for the remission of sins that are past. The sins you have committed in the past, the sins that are past, the sins you have dabbled into secretly or publicly, the sins of the past is now able to cleanse, is now able to remove, is now able to forgive, because you have faith in his blood. It says through the forbearance of God to declare, verse 26, I say at this time his righteousness, that he might be just and the justifier of him that believeth in Jesus. What does that mean? That he might be just. What it means is, you committed sin, or you committed sins in the plural, and you are guilty for every one of them. You committed sin against the eternal law of God, the great law of God, the supernatural power of God then has the ability to punish that sin with eternal punishment. And because you have come to Jesus and you tell the Almighty God, he bore my sin, Jesus has taken my sin away, God, to be just, can only punish sin once. And because he's punished on Christ, that sets you free. That's what it means, that he is just. And now he's the justifier of them that believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. Look at chapter 5, verse 1. Chapter 5, verse 1. Therefore, being justified by faith, remember, is the justifier of him that believes on the Lord Jesus Christ. Is the one that sets him free. He has believed on the Lord Jesus Christ. He was guilty, but because he applied unto the Heavenly Father, because of Jesus, on the merits of Jesus, on the sacrifice of Jesus, because of that, he is now justified. He believes, and justification has come. He will not be punished again. The Lord has taken the guilt and the condemnation away. Verse 1, chapter 5, therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God. Before that, to you, God was the judge. He was the one that will punish your sin. But now, because you have come through the blood, you have been pardoned, you have been forgiven, that sin has been taken away, the guilt is gone, the condemnation is gone. Because of that, now you see him as Father, and you have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Look at verse 6 there, that chapter 5. For when we were yet without strength, in due time Christ died for the ungodly. Christ died for the ungodly. That means he died for everybody, because everybody was sinful. Everybody was ungodly. And because everyone was ungodly, and he has died for the ungodly, he died for you. For scarcely for a righteous man will one die. Yet, peradventure, for a good man, some would even dare venture to die. But God commendeth his love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. It's not waiting until you turn over a new leaf before the death can be effective, efficacious in your life. It's not waiting until you can make yourself better. He is the one to make you better. He is the one to forgive you. He is the one to set you free. He is the one to cleanse you. He is the one to purge you. You can come just as you are, but he will not send you away just as you are. He will forgive. He will set free. He will transform your life. He will change your life. He'll make you a new creature in Christ. Transformation comes with that forgiveness. Renewal comes with that forgiveness. Regeneration, that he makes you anew afresh, that comes with that forgiveness. Then it says in verse 9, much more then, being justified by his blood. Underline that in your Bible. By his blood, he justifies. By his blood, he saves. By his blood, he transforms your life. Being justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him. That's a great benefit. Eternal wrath is taken away. Eternal sojourn in hell is taken away. Eternal punishment is taken away. The wrath of God is removed because of that atonement of Jesus Christ. For if, when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his son, much more, being reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. That's talking about our redemption. That's talking about the forgiveness, the pardon, the peace, the relationship, reconciliation that we now have with the Almighty God because of the sacrifice of Jesus, because of the shedding of the blood of Jesus for us. Ephesians chapter 1. In Ephesians chapter 1, reading from verse 7. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 7. In whom we have redemption through his blood. Think of redemption. In whom we have redemption through his blood. Forgiveness is in that redemption. Peace of God is in that redemption. Freedom is in that redemption. Actually, the word redemption comes from the fact of people being sold into slavery. And anybody that comes to redeem them, to take them, to rescue them from that slavery is called the Redeemer. And what they have got through that is the redemption. And it says, you know, we have redemption. We have the freedom. It sets us free from the power of sin, from the hold of sin. It sets us free from the hold of Satan. It sets us free from the imprisonment and from the enslavement of sin. That's what it says there. It gives us redemption, forgiveness, freedom, liberty. Now we can have dominion because we're no more slaves of sin. That's what the blood of Jesus Christ does. If you have not got that, I believe that today as you come to the Lord and you turn away from evil and say, Lord, this is what I want, total redemption, so that I will not continue being a slave to sin, a slave to bad habit, a slave to evil, a slave to all the lives I've lived in the past. He will do it for you. In whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. Ephesians chapter 2, reading here from verse 11. Ephesians chapter 2, reading from verse 11. It grants us pardon. It grants us forgiveness. It grants us peace. It grants us reconciliation with God. It grants us total serenity, peace of mind. Ephesians chapter 2, reading from verse 11. Wherefore, remember that you've been in time past Gentiles in the flesh, who are called uncircumcision by that which is called the circumcision in the flesh made by hands, that at that time before redemption, at that time before the pardon, at that time before justification, at that time before you were cleansed with the blood of Jesus Christ, at that time before you applied the full efficacy of the blood of Jesus Christ in your soul, in your spirit, in your life, but because at that time ye were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers from the covenant of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. See the state of the sinner, the state of the one that is not redeemed yet, the state of the one that has not applied the blood of Jesus Christ by faith. You see the state in which they are. It says they're without Christ, without the covenant of promise, and without the privilege of Calvary. And then it says without God in this world. It says but now when you come to Christ, but now when you repent, but now when you turn away from your sin, but now when you realize the blood of Jesus can make you clean, it says but now when you realize there's salvation in Christ, it says but now when you realize you don't have to perish, you don't have to be without God, without Christ, without salvation, it says but now in Christ Jesus, ye who sometimes were far off are made nice by the blood of Christ. That's reconciliation. Made nice by the blood of Christ. Reconciled by the blood of Christ. Forgiven by the blood of Christ. Brought into the presence of God by the blood of Christ. Brought into relationship with God by the blood of Christ. That's the only thing that can bring you into relationship with God. Because a sinner cannot maintain relationship with God. God is holy. God is righteous. God is pure. And you are separated from God. Your sin separates you from God. But the blood of Jesus Christ that provides forgiveness, the blood of Jesus Christ that grants that reconciliation, is the one thing that brings you peace with the Lord. It goes on in verse 14, for he is our peace. That's Jesus. He is our peace. The one who shed his blood for you, he is our peace. The one that grants you pardon, that grants you forgiveness, the one that brings you reconciliation with God, he is our peace. The one who takes your place and he bore your sin, and you can have his righteousness. The one who gave his life as a substitute for you, for he is our peace, who has made both one and has broken down the middle wall of partition between us. The wall of partition between the Jews and the Gentiles broken down. The wall of partition between the sinner and God broken down. Reconciliation has now taken place. And newness of life has now come. A new relationship has now come. And it is through the blood of Jesus Christ. There are many people that do not realize that this reconciliation with God and this partnership with God, this relationship with God, is so very important, because that's what brings you very close to the Lord himself. Having abolished in his flesh the enmity, even the law of commandments contained in ordinances, for to make in himself of twain one new man, so making peace. Again, it reminds you that you have peace with God, and you have peace in your heart, and you have peace with the brethren, and that he might reconcile both to God, the Jew, the Gentile, both to God. And it's through the blood of Jesus Christ that this is done. There's no reconciliation through any other means. Religion does not bring reconciliation. And whatever you do by yourself does not bring reconciliation. But it is what Christ has done. the shedding of the blood of Jesus Christ, that he might bring reconciliation, he might reconcile both unto God in one body by his cross, having slain the enmity thereby. And in verse 16, and that he might reconcile both to God in one body by his cross, having slain the enmity thereby. And he came and he preached peace to you, proclaimed peace to you, and declared peace to you, and he's brought the peace unto you which were afar off, and to them which were nigh, afar off, the Gentiles, and those who were near, the Jews. And then, for through him we both have access by one Spirit unto the Father. Now therefore, saved, now therefore, justified, now therefore, having peace with God, now therefore, reconciled unto God, now therefore, ye are no more strangers. Are you washed in the blood of Jesus? Then you are no more strangers and foreigners. Have you been reconciled unto God by the shedding of the blood of Christ? Now ye are no more strangers and foreigners. Have you got that peace of God and that pardon? Does the Spirit bear witness with your heart that you are now a child of God, and the presence of Christ within keeps you victorious over the sins of the past? It says, now therefore ye are no more strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and of the household of God. It tells us in 1 Peter chapter 1, 1 Peter chapter 1, the means of our reconciliation with God, the means of our relationship with God. 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 18 and 19. For as much as you know, if you have experienced this salvation, if you have experienced this peace, if you have got this pardon, if your heart is now free, if the burden of sin has been taken away, if the guilt of sin has been cancelled, if there's a freedom within, and if there is now victory over the sins of the past, now you know. For as much as you know that ye were not redeemed with corruptible things, as silver and gold from your vain conversation, received by tradition from your fathers, but for the precious blood of Christ. That's the means of our salvation, the precious blood of Christ. That's what gives us the pardon, the precious blood of Christ. That's what gives us the peace, the precious blood of Christ. That's what gives us the freedom, bought with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb without blemish and without spot. That's what Jesus said in Matthew chapter 28. Matthew chapter 26, verse 28. Matthew chapter 26, verse 28. For this is my blood of the New Testament, of the New Covenant. The old covenant being celebrated by the Passover feast was passing away. And then Jesus turned to his own disciples. He said, the Passover of the Jews will now stop here, will end here. And he says, because a new dawn, a new dispensation, a new covenant is being put in place right now. And this is now the blood, my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for many for the remission of sins. This is what takes the guilt of sin away. It takes the power of sin away. It takes the presence of sin away. It takes the punishment for sin, takes it away. This is the blood of Jesus, grants us peace with God, grants us pardon from God. Goes beyond that, grants us purity and power. We come to point number two now, purity and power through his blood. The same blood that grants us salvation also grants us sanctification. The same blood that grants us forgiveness also grants us freedom. The same blood that grants us peace and pardon also grants us purity and power over sin. We come to Hebrews chapter 9. Hebrews chapter 9, and I'm reading from verse 12. Hebrews chapter 9, verse 12. In the old age, that's the blood the Jewish people have relied on from the time of Moses until the time of Christ. That's the blood that stops in its efficacy at the point of the cross of Jesus Christ. That's why it says it's no more by the blood of goats and calves, but by his own blood. It's referring to Christ. By his own blood, he entered in once into the holy place, having obtained eternal redemption for us. He went to heaven and he showed the Almighty God the Father, the judge of all the earth. He said, look at my blood shed for the people. I obtained redemption, and not just temporary redemption, eternal redemption for all that will believe and keep on believing on me. In verse 13, for if the blood of bulls and goats in the old covenant and the ashes of an heifer sprinkling the unclean sanctifies thee to the purifying of the flesh in the old covenant. Now in the new covenant, verse 14, how much more? You think about the people of the old covenant, people like Enoch that had victory over sin, old covenant. You think of a person like Samuel that had victory over sin, and just that's old covenant. You think about Abraham that became the friend of God, that's the old covenant. You think about Moses, about Joshua, about the people of the old covenant that the Lord approved of their lives. You think about Elijah, Elisha, old covenant. And it says all those people, they got the victory through the blood of goats and bulls. Because at that time, in their own time, that was the sacrifice God appointed for them, waiting for the time of Christ. It says, if they had sought victory at that time, if they had sought purity at that time, if Daniel in Babylon had such righteousness, godliness, purity, holiness at that time, only by the sacrifice of the blood of bulls and of goats, how much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, purge your conscience, purge your heart, that means purify your heart, sanctify your heart from dead works to serve the living God. Look at that verse again, verse 14. It says, look at what the old covenant people had, the pardon they have. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that was within me, bless his holy name. Old covenant, who forgiveth all thine iniquities. Old covenant, who healeth all the diseases. Old covenant. He said, if that happened to the Old Testament people by the blood of goats and bulls, how much more if he pardoned them then, if he purified them then, people like Isaiah, your sin is taken away and you are purged. If that happened to them, how much more? If you say you cannot be righteous and pure, holy and godly, you kind of belittle the blood of Jesus Christ. The blood of animals made them pure at that time in the old covenant. And today, that same blood will purge you, purify you, sanctify you, make you holy through and through. And you'll be higher, holier, purer than the Old Testament people, how much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal spirit, all those Old Testament sacrifices offered by those priests of the old covenant, they were faulty. They themselves were sinful. And they didn't offer those sacrifices by the eternal spirit. It's telling you how high the sacrifice of Jesus is, how effective the blood of Jesus Christ is. He offered himself through the eternal spirit. And then it says, without spot. And he offered himself to God. Now you'll purge your conscience and purge your spirit and purge your heart from dead works, and you'll be able to serve the living God. 1 John chapter 1, verse 7. 1 John chapter 1, reading from verse 7, the blood of Jesus, the benefits we have through that blood, the purifying we have through that blood, the holiness we have through that blood, and the renewed cleansing of the heart by that blood. 1 John chapter 1 verse 8. But if we walk in the light, why wouldn't we? After you are pardoned, why wouldn't you walk in the light after you are reconciled unto God? Why wouldn't you? If you're walking with God and walking with the Lord, because two cannot walk together except we be agreed. And he is light, and in him is no darkness at all. If we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another. We have understanding, unity one with another. The division is gone. The wall of partition is broken down. The hatred between the Jews and the Gentiles, all that is gone. And between Gentile and Gentile, all those conflicts are gone. We now have fellowship, reconciliation, relationship, love, one with another. And then it says, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanses us from all sin, purges us from all sin, purifies us from all sin, sets us free from all sin. It tells us in Hebrews chapter 10. Hebrews chapter 10. I'm reading here from verse 19. Hebrews chapter 10. Reading from verse 19. Hebrews 10, verse 19. It says, having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter into the holiest by the blood of Jesus. Having now boldness to enter. You are no more doubting, you are no more vacillating, you are not no more going up and down in your mind. You are no more questioning in your mind. Can I be holy? Can I be pure? Can I be sanctified? Can I live a life that is transparently holy? He said, look at what Jesus has done. Look at the blood he has shed. And look at the effect of that blood. And look at the efficacy of the blood of Jesus Christ. Now you should have the assurance to enter into the very presence of the Lord and be as holy as Calvary can make you. As holy as the blood of Jesus Christ can make you. As righteous and godly, as purified as the blood of the Lamb can make you. And even enter into the holiest, the holiest sanctuary, and the holiest experience, and the holiest state of mind by the blood of the Lamb. It says, having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter into the holiest by the blood of Jesus. Is there any inward sin you have been thinking, that's my peculiar fault, I cannot overcome that? Is there anything that you have been excusing and allowing in your heart? That's my peculiarity. I can overcome others. I can be victorious on others. But this is peculiar. You have not applied the blood of Jesus to that peculiar situation of yours. You can come this morning to the holiest, and then the Lord can so purge you and you'll be purer than you have ever experienced in your life, because the blood has been shed and it's not going to shed the blood again. All that he needs to do to sanctify you and to make you holy and to purify your life, he's done everything. And now we have boldness to enter into the holiest by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way which he has consecrated for us through the veil, that is to say his flesh. And now he is the high priest of our profession. In chapter 13, I'm reading just Hebrews chapter 13, I'm reading from verses 12 and 13. Hebrews chapter 13 verse 12, wherefore Jesus also, that he might sanctify the people with his own blood. Join those two things together. Sanctification is own blood. Sanctification by his own blood. When you come to the full realization of what Calvary has provided, you will not stop at salvation. Because Jesus also, that he might sanctify the people, purify the people, make the people transparently holy with his own blood, is suffered outside the gate without the gate. Let us go forth therefore unto him without the camp, outside the camp, bearing his reproach. The people who do not know the power in the blood of the Lamb might reproach you, might ridicule you, might make fun of you. It says, bear that and count the glory that shall come greater than all the reproaches of the day, and count the wonder of that sanctification and the wonder of the purity of heart and purity of life higher and greater than whatever reproaches people may level against you. Verse 20, it says, now the God of peace that brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant. There's no other covenant after the covenant of the blood of Jesus. Is the new covenant, is the last covenant, is the everlasting covenant. Through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good work, to do his will, working in you that which is well pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. And everybody said, amen. Amen. See, you can come and be cleansed in that blood. You can come and be washed in that blood. Purification will come. And then you'll be able to rejoice in the Lord, saying, I am saved. Have peace with God. I am saved. I have pardon. I am sanctified. I have purity. I am made holy. I have that power over sin. That's what it takes. And that's what the blood will do. Without holiness, no man shall see the Lord. And we get that holiness, that purity of heart, that sanctification through the blood that Jesus shed for us on the cross of Calvary. And now we can come to the throne of grace to receive, and receive at his hand. In Revelation chapter 7, you'll discover that multitudes receive this experience through the blood of the Lamb. Multitudes are saved, they are pardoned, they are peace, they are sanctified, they are purity, they are power over sin through the blood of the Lamb. If multitudes have got it, if multitudes will get it, you should be one of them. Revelation chapter 7 verse 9. After this I beheld, and lo, a great multitude which no man could number, of all nations and kindreds and people and tongues, stood before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed with white robes and palms in their hands, and cried with a loud voice, saying, salvation to our God, which sitteth upon the throne, and unto the Lamb. And all the angels stood round about the throne, and about the elders, and the four beasts, and fell, the four living creatures, and he fell before the throne on their faces, and worshipped God, saying, Amen. Blessing, and glory, and wisdom, and thanksgiving, and honor, and power, and might be unto our God forever and ever. Amen. And one of the elders answered, saying unto me, What are these which are arrayed in white robes? Whence came they? And I said unto him, Sir, thou knowest. And he said to me, These are they. Listen to this. These are they which came out of great trial, great temptation, great trouble, great tribulation. That's not the great tribulation, great tribulation, great trials, great difficulties, great persecution. And they have washed their robes and made them white. How? I said, how? Tell me out loud. In the blood of the Lamb. For you to be holy enough to get to heaven is the blood of the Lamb. Pure enough to get to heaven is the blood of the Lamb. The one you try by yourself, I'll not do this, I'll not do that, that's not sufficient. That one will have blemish, that one will have spot, that one will have failure. But when you come to the throne of grace and you say, I need genuine salvation, free, that makes me victorious, I need real sanctification, real cleansing, purifying, that gives me the holiness that God himself will recognize and approve of, that's going to take the blood of the Lamb. These are they which have come out of great tribulation, and they have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Therefore, look at that word, therefore, because they are washed, therefore, because they are cleansed, therefore, because they're purified, therefore, and because they are sanctified, made holy, therefore, are they before the throne of God and serve him day and night in his temple. And he that sitteth on the throne shall dwell among them. They shall hunger no more, neither thirst any more, neither shall the sun light on them, nor any heat. For the Lamb, which is in the midst of the throne, shall feed them, and shall lead them unto living water, living fountains of waters. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. It's the blood of the Lamb that does that, and so cleanses you, and so purges you, and so purifies you, and makes you ready, ready for heaven. Ephesians chapter 5. I'm reading from verse 25. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 25. Husbands, love your wives, you will if you are born again. Husbands, love your wives. That's the commandment of the Lord. And if you are born again, you'll fulfill, you'll obey that. Even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it. Christ loved the church and gave himself for it. You understand? Christ loved the world. He gave himself for the salvation of the world, for the pardon, for the peace of the world. Salvation. But now the church is through that same love of Christ, the love that saved the world, the people coming out of the world, that love that made Christ die for us, he gave himself for us, that he might sanctify and cleanse the church with the washing of water by the word, that he might present the church to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that it should be holy and without blemish. that he does by his blood, the cleansing in his blood, the purifying through his blood, the purging through his blood. It says, he did that, that he might cleanse us, that he might sanctify us, that he might purify us and present us to himself a glorious church, not having spot. That's talking about things that are not conducive or conforming to the glory of God, or wrinkle, the marks of the old nature, the marks of the old man, the characteristics of the old life, wrinkle, or any such thing, but that it should be holy and without blemish. Revelation chapter 19. In Revelation chapter 19, reading from verse 7, let us be glad and rejoice and give honor to him, honor to the Lord, for the marriage of the Lamb is come, and his wife has made herself ready. How? Look at verse 8. And to her was granted that she should be arrayed in fine linen, clean and white. For the fine linen is the righteousness of the saints. That's the righteousness, the godliness, the purity, the sanctification it grants to the saints. And to get to heaven, you need that. And it comes through the blood of Jesus Christ. Number one, peace and pardon. Number two, purity and power. Number three, protection and provision in his blood, or through his blood. It is that blood, the blood of the Lamb, the blood flowing from Calvary, the blood of Jesus Christ, the blood is shed for you, the same blood that grants peace and pardon, that same blood that grants purity and power over sin, that's the same blood that grants protection and provision. We're going back to Exodus, but you must always remember, whatever we read in the old covenant concerning the blood of the animals that were shed, when you come to the new covenant, we have something higher, something greater. And we're reading the Old Testament concerning the blood of the animals that were shed, concerning the blood that was shed in the old covenant. We're reading to make contrast, to tell you, or to tell ourselves, if they got that in the old covenant, how much more will the blood of Jesus Christ do that same thing and do much more for us? And then we come by faith and we appropriate and we receive that which we're reading about. Exodus chapter 12, and I'm reading from verse 12. For I will pass through the land of Egypt this night. I will smite all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both man and beast. And against all the gods of Egypt will I execute judgment. I am the Lord. You understand what the Lord was saying? Judgment was coming upon Egypt because of their idolatry. Judgment was coming upon Egypt because of their rejection of the word of the Lord. Judgment was coming upon Egypt because of their evil, because of their sin. But now the children of Israel were given the plan of redemption. And the plan of redemption was this, that they will look at all their houses. They will clear leaven out of their houses. Leaven was a symbol of sin, a symbol of evil, a symbol of contagious evil. That is a sin that affects other people like leprosy. They will look at their houses and clear all the leaven away. Not only that, they will separate themselves from the idols of the land and from the gods of the land. and then they will now shed the blood of the animal. You know what that means? It's like they will repent of their sin. They will take away everything that symbolizes sin in their lives. Take all the leaven away, clear the leaven, cleanse the leaven away from them. And all through that period, they will not eat anything that has leaven. Look at verse 15. 7 days shall ye eat unleavened bread. Even from the first day, ye shall put away leaven out of your houses. For whosoever, listen to this, whosoever eateth leavened bread from the first day until the seventh day, that soul shall be cut off from Israel. Many people do not understand that part of Exodus chapter 12. They don't think about the repentance, about the taking away of the leaven. They just say, when I see the blood, I will pass over you. The leaven may be there. When I see the blood, I will pass over you. The gods of Egypt, idols of Egypt may still be there. When I see the blood, I will pass over you. No, not at all. No, not at all. Anyone among the children of Israel, even after shedding the blood of the animal, and after staying under the cover of that animal, if it's not stricken, not smitten by the evil angel, the angel of the pastor of the land, if he ate anything of leaven during that period, he'll still be cut off by the judgment of God. They take the leaven away, and they take all the evil things away. It says from the first day in verse 16, in the first day, there shall be an holy convocation, and in the seventh day there shall be an holy convocation to you. No manner of work shall be done in them, save that which every man must eat, that only may be done of you. And then it says, and ye shall observe the feast of unleavened bread. Unleavened bread. Come back now to verse 13. And the blood shall be to you for a token upon the houses where ye are. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you. And the plague shall not come upon you to destroy you when I smite the land of Egypt. If they took to the commandment of the Lord and did what he told them to do, and they applied the blood by faith, as he told them to do, there will be protection for them. Look at verse 22. And ye shall take a bunch of hyssop and dip it in the blood that is in the basin, and strike the lintel and the two side posts with blood that is in the basin, and none of you shall go out at the door of his house until the morning. They will stay under the protection of that blood. Obedience was still required. Faithfulness was still required. And being conscious of the commandments of God, that was still required as they shed the blood. It's not just that, okay, I've shed the blood, I believe in that blood, and then I'm at liberty to do whatever. No, the commandments of God were still clear. It says, for the Lord will pass through to smite the Egyptians, and when he sees the blood upon the lintel and on the two side posts, the Lord will pass over the door and will not suffer the destroyer to come in unto your houses to smite you. And those provisions of the Lord has now made available for us in the new covenant. In Acts of the Apostles chapter 20. Acts of the Apostles chapter 20. And I'm reading here from verse 28. Acts of the Apostles chapter 20. Verse 28, it tells us in verse 28, take heed therefore unto yourselves and to all the flock over the which the Holy Ghost has made you overseers to feed the church of God. What kind of church? Which he has purchased with his own blood. As the children of Israel were purchased by the shedding of that blood, and God said, they are now mine. They are my sons and daughters through the shedding of that blood. Now we are purchased by the blood of Jesus, the blood of the Lamb. What redeemed, what renewed, what reconciled unto God. They were purchased by the blood of animals. We are purchased by the blood of Jesus Christ. Exodus chapter 15. In Exodus chapter 15, we're reading from verse 16. Exodus chapter 15, verse 16. Fear and dread shall fall upon them, upon the enemies, by the greatness of thine arm. They shall be as steel as a stone, till the people pass over, O Lord, till the people pass over, which thou hast purchased, which thou hast purchased. They were purchased by the blood of animals. We are purchased by the blood of Jesus Christ. Now we belong to God because he has purchased us. In 1 Corinthians chapter 6, 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 19. What? Know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you, which ye have of God, and ye are not your own, for ye are bought, purchased with a price. What price? The blood of Jesus. And because he has purchased us, we now totally, completely belong unto him. And because of that, we have protection. And because of that, we have all the provision that Calvary has made available for us. And anytime you can come to the presence of the Lord, and you can say, on the basis of the blood of the Lamb, of on the basis of that purchase by the Lord Jesus Christ through his blood, all the benefits from Calvary can then flow into your life. We're looking at verse 20, for ye are bought with a price. Therefore glorify God within your body and in your spirit, which are God's. Because you have been purchased by that blood, you now glorify him. You now honor him. He has purchased you for just one purpose. That's with your life, with everything you do, everywhere you are, you are to glorify him. Anything that will not glorify the Lord, you will not do. Anything that will not honor the Lord, you will not do, because you are purchased just for that purpose. In Isaiah chapter 43, Isaiah chapter 43 verse 7, you belong to God, he's pardoned you. You belong to God, he has given you peace. You belong to God, he provides purity for you. You belong to God, he grants you power over every evil thing. And you belong to God, he grants you protection, and he grants you provision, all that you need for your life and for godliness. Because of that, now you understand, because you belong to God, see how you are to live. Isaiah chapter 43 verse 7, even everyone that is called by my name, for I have created him, redeemed him, recreated him for my glory. I have formed him, yea, I have made him. And then he tells us in verse 21, these people have I formed for myself. For myself. You understand now? Because you are purchased. And because he's brought you to himself, reconciled unto God by the blood of the Lamb, is no more what I want, where I want to go, what I want to do. Even the blessings you're asking of, you're asking from the Lord, you ask so that you can glorify the Lord more. These people have I formed for myself, they shall show forth my praise. Old covenant people redeemed by the blood of animals, they shall show forth my praise. I've called them, I've recreated them, I have purchased them, I brought them to myself. They shall show forth my praise. New covenant people who are bought by the blood of the Lamb, who have been provided for by the blood of the Lamb. What are they to do? 1 Peter chapter 2 verse 9. 1 Peter chapter 2 verse 9. For ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, an holy nation, a peculiar people. That's why we're purchased. That's why salvation is available. That's why sanctification is available. That's why all the blessings that Calvary has provided, that's why they're available. Because now we are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, and holy nation, a peculiar people, that ye should show forth the praises of him who has called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. What a wonderful thing he has done. And this morning you can come unto the Lord once again and have the boldness, the courage to enter into the holiest by the blood of the Lamb. Because he's made this new and living way for you, for me, for every one of us. And purity is available, peace available, pardon available, power available, protection available. All the provision Calvary has given, they're all available. In Revelation chapter 12, Revelation chapter 12, and I'm reading here from verse 9. And the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceives the whole world. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. And I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now is come salvation and strength and the kingdom of God and the power of his Christ, for the accuser of our brethren is cast down, which accused them before our God day and night, and they overcame him by, tell me, and overcame him by what? The blood of the Lamb. It gives us victory, gives us power, gives us authority, gives us boldness, and makes us more than a conqueror, even to overcome the devil, overcome the demons, overcome anything the devil can do. They overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimonies, and they loved not their lives unto the death. This morning we can come to the Lord. As you come to the Lord, you can come boldly. You don't need another person to, you know, go in there before you go and get pardon for me. You'll come and get it yourself. Go and get the peace of mind for me. You can get it yourself. Christ has made it available. And go and get purity for me. You'll get it yourself. He's done it for you. Go and get a power for me. I want to be victorious. You'll get it yourself. Protection, preservation, provision. Everything is available. And now you can come. Having therefore, brethren, boldness to come into the holiest by the blood of Jesus, let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith. You have faith this morning, don't you? I said you have faith this morning, don't you? We can come to the Lord, and as you come, he will give you all the provision and the benefit. He'll give us that. It's available. Let's come before the Lord. And sanctification, purity of heart and holiness, he makes available. Protection, provision, everything Calvary has provided is yours today. Open your mouth and talk to the Lord in prayer.